Praise the Lord, everybody. God bless you. We're glad that you're tuned in tonight. Praise God. We're going to get into some things in just a few moments, picking up some things from where we left off last time. And I believe you're going to be blessed by what you hear tonight. Just before we get into the word, let's go before the Lord in prayer and expect Him to do some mighty things for us tonight. Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for this opportunity to come before you. Thank you for all that you have done. Thank you for what you're doing at this moment. Thank you for what you will do momentarily through the Word of God and by your Holy Spirit. Thank you that your Word is true. We can rely upon it. We can trust it. We can put our lives on it because it is real. You're not a man that you should lie, neither the Son of Man that you should repent. If you said it, you will do it. If you spoke it, you will make it good. Thank you, Lord. Now, Father, I thank you also for this moment. And I yield to the Holy Spirit that you may have your own way. Use me for your glory. Minister to people. Bring answers to questions. Bring light, illumination, inspiration, and even revelation by the Spirit in the mighty name of Jesus. I thank you that not one person tuned in will be the same, that they will be touched and blessed and made new. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Praise God. I want to go back over some things that I said. I'm going to read something to you. And this is our fourth time dealing with this, but continuing, and tonight we're going to conclude with some things I want to talk about. Thank God for all the things that have been said in the past, and we're going to go into a few other things and see where the Lord takes us tonight. I had said that some time ago I'd been praying and talking to the Lord about some things. I paid attention to things happening and people not receiving and things of that nature. And I want to just read this to you again. I know I did it every week, praise God, and we're going to continue to do it. Now, let's go back here. Now, I wrote this in March of last year, March the 14th, actually. And I wrote it down because I'd been dealing with some things about receiving from God and how to receive from Him and so forth, and thinking about those things. And I'm always thinking about people and what happens. And I don't know about you, but I like success and not failure. And when I'm always learning, I'm always questioning, I'm always trying to find out why things happen the way they do, because I know the Bible is always right. The Bible can't be wrong. God can't be wrong. It's the Word of God. God cannot be wrong. So if something is not working, if we're seeing something in the Word and it don't seem to be working for us, we need to find out where we are missing, because God can't miss. So it's always on our end that we're missing. It's never God. We can be misunderstanding something, misapplying something, having lack of knowledge of something. There's all kinds of things that we can do that keeps it from happening. And just because you quote a scripture don't mean that you're in faith about that particular scripture. I'm going to say some other things in a few minutes about some of that. But I was thinking about that and thinking about healing. And so let me read what I wrote here. I have been praying recently about why people fail to receive healing, although they profess to believe. This morning, this is March the 14th, 2019, in a series of dreams, the Lord spoke to me and gave me some insight. Now the following is what I received. It was three dreams, one behind the other, in the same night. And in each one, the Lord was speaking to me, was talking to me in the dreams. And it was like teaching me, explaining certain things to me. And I'm giving you a summary of what was said there. And he said, part of it is this: very often people are able to quote healing scriptures. And when you say healing scriptures, we mean scriptures that pertain to healing, of course. He said, very often people are able to quote healing scriptures verbatim and also make confessions of faith, which we're going to talk about tonight in a minute, and also make confessions of faith according to those scriptures. However, they do not know how to apply them in order to procure their healing. And I want to say that. I want to read that again. Very often, people are able to quote healing scriptures, and then for that matter, you know, faith works the same. The principle of faith works the same if you're believing for healing or for finance or for whatever it is you're believing God for. It's the same. The principle is the same. So let me say that again. Very often people are able to quote healing scriptures verbatim and also make confessions of faith according to those scriptures. However, they do not know how to apply them in order to procure their healing. They don't know how to apply the scripture. They don't say it. They can know how to say what it says or confess it, if you will, but they do not know how to apply it. He shared this, this is something else that came out. Some can teach these scriptures to others by simply repeating what they've heard. They seem to understand what they're teaching, but they do not. They know how to articulate it, but they do not understand how to walk in it for themselves. I know this is absolutely true because I've seen it. I've talked to people personally, and I'm talking to them about healing. They may be having some challenge, and they can quote all the scriptures. They know where everything is, and they'll tell me, I know I'm believing. I'm believing God and so forth. But after a period of time, something changes, and they start changing in what they're saying, because now things are beginning to bother them. It confuses people when they're praying and it doesn't seem to be getting any better, instead getting worse. Well, there's a reason why that happens, and we'll talk about some of that as we go on here. But let me go on and say some of the other things that the Lord brought to me. They seem to understand what they're teaching, but they do not. They know how to articulate it, but they do not know They do not understand how to walk in it for themselves. The problem is in the application of God's word. The scriptures must be applied to the heart. Faith is of the heart. We're talking about the God kind of faith, the kind of faith that's going to get you results. Faith is of the heart. There's a difference between knowing the scriptures intellectually and knowing them on a heart level. There's a difference between knowing them, knowing the scriptures intellectually and knowing them on a heart level. Those who have difficulty receiving, in other words, receiving answers to their prayers, those who have difficulty receiving what they're praying for, have only an intellectual knowledge of the word. I want to say that again. Those who have difficulty receiving, they pray and they have difficulty receiving, it's because they only have an intellectual knowledge of the word. Now, I know people will argue with me about that and disagree with me, but you will be wrong because what I said is true. Not because I said it, I'm just telling you how it works. If you had heart faith, heart level faith, heart level knowledge of the word, you will get what you desire. It's not like God might not want you to have it and those kinds of things. When you're praying like that and you're not even sure, you should not even pray until you are sure. You need to know what the word says about it before you start praying. The secret, really, to receiving answers to prayer is praying the word. God is always, always going to operate according to his word. Always. I'm not fighting and questioning. If I desire healing, I need to know what the word of God says about it. And very often people don't know what the word of God says about it, and they have these ideas about it, and they think things like, well, God chooses who he's going to heal. Or it may not be God's will to heal me. Maybe he wants me to go through this. Maybe he wants me to suffer this way. For what? Now hold on to your seat, because if you're religious, this is going to mess with you. But let me tell you what that actually is. Pride. It's pride. For you to think that God, some kind of way, chose you, special you, to suffer in some terrible way so that you could be some kind of a blessing to somebody else, or a testimony to someone else, or have a testimony for someone else. That's not according to the scriptures. That's according to religion and religious teaching and religious ideas, but it's not according to the word of God. Jesus was wounded for our transgressions, not some of our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, not some of our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, not some. And with his stripes, we are healed, not some. We. That's not even a promise. That's not a promise. That is a stated fact. It's actually something that happened. He was wounded for our transgressions. You know how the scripture says, in John 3:16, how that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. That's a fact, right? It actually happened. Now, there are many people who hear that and reject it. They say, I don't believe that. I don't believe in God. How do you know there's God? That's true. How do you know there's a real God? Who wrote the Bible? I mean, people come up with a gazillion questions to talk themselves out of accepting what the word of God says. Well, does it change the fact that Jesus actually died for us? Does it change the fact that God sent his son? No. So what people believe or choose to believe or don't believe is doesn't make it true or untrue. It's true whether you believe it or not. Just like Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man come to the Father but by me. Now, many people that claim to be Christians want to look for some kind of other way. It got to be some other way. It's got to be a lot of paths to God and all of this. And people have all these things that are, and they say all these things that are contrary to the Bible. It doesn't change the fact that Jesus is the only way. He's the only way, whether you like it or not. More people are going to hell than heaven, whether you like it or not. God doesn't even like it, and yet it's going to happen because he doesn't control that. He didn't make us robots. We are free moral agents. We have the right of choice. We have the right to choose and the ability to choose. Praise God. That's a fact. Well, nothing changes about God on the basis of what you and I believe. The only thing that changes is us. Something will change for you or not change for you on the basis of what you believe or don't believe. But nothing changes for God. God is who he is, who he says he is. He's always the same. He will never change. He'll never be anything different. He'll never be anything less or more, for that matter. He is what he is. He is who he is. And so that doesn't change. And so when the scripture says he was wounded for our transgression, that happened. Whether you believe it or not is another discussion. That already happened. He was bruised for our iniquities. That already happened. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. That already happened. And with his stripes, we are healed. That already happened. The problem is that people don't understand that God is a spirit. And as I said a couple of weeks ago, you know, one of the problems that people have is that we have a carnal mind. We're trying to know God from a physical standpoint. And we're trying to contact him with our bodies and with our, you know, with our physical senses. And so if something is not happening in our body like we think it's supposed to happen, then we think that somehow God is, you know, not doing it or not answering. And you see, that's really a carnal mind. That's not a spiritual mind. That's a carnal mind. And when I say a carnal mind, that doesn't mean you're sinful as such. It just simply means that you're natural minded. You're being dominated by your natural thoughts as opposed to being dominated by what the Word of God says. You see, I think that what the attitude that we should have is we don't judge the Bible by our experience, but rather we judge the experience by the Bible. If he says with his stripes, I am healed, but my experience is saying something different, I need to find out how to have my experience to line up with what he said. And there is a way to do it, which is what we're talking about a little bit here tonight. And so that already happened. Since that already happened, I'm not going to be praying prayers like, Lord, if it's your will, heal me. Well, how are you going to use faith? How are you going to exercise faith? How can you? Let me give you this definition of faith. Faith is being the God kind of faith, the Bible, biblical faith, is being fully persuaded. That's strong faith. Being fully persuaded of something that have not come into contact with your physical senses. You believe it as though you actually can see it, and yet you cannot. You believe it as though you can actually feel it, and yet you cannot. You believe it as though it has come into contact with your physical senses, and yet it has not. But you're just as convinced without having it contact your senses as you would be if you actually had it in your hand. Years ago, I remember, I'll never forget it, the Lord spoke to me by his spirit like he speaks to everybody. And he said this to me. He said, I'm going to teach you something about faith. This is many years ago, probably in the late 1970s. But he said this to me, and I'll never forget it. He said, I'm going to teach you something about faith. Whenever you're believing me for something, you must see through the eyes of faith yourself having that thing. I had never heard that expression before, the eyes of faith. I didn't know what he was talking about. I was not familiar with that. I had an idea what he was saying, but I was just not familiar with that term. I never heard that term before. He said, you must, whenever you're believing me for something, you must see through the eyes of faith yourself having that thing, having it. He said, and then you must begin to rejoice in the same manner that you would rejoice if you actually had it in your hand. That's totally according to the scripture. Abraham had that kind of faith. Abraham considered, when he was about 100 years old, he considered his own body now dead, neither the deadness of his wife's womb, Sarah's womb. And I call her twice dead because she couldn't have children. From a reproductive standpoint, she was dead, double dead, because first, she was dead even when she was in childbearing years. And then second, old age has set in and she's past the time where she can have children. That's in the natural. If Abraham had said, that's not possible, that ain't gonna happen, that can't, I don't know, I don't think that can happen, he would not have it would not have happened for him. But he had to believe. God changed his name from Abram to Abraham because the name Abraham means father of many nations. Now God is talking to a man that had no children and calling him father of many nations. He's calling things that be not as though they were. He calling things that are not as though they were. He's calling Abraham. Every time he calls Abraham's name, or every time somebody else calls Abraham's name, they calling him father of many nations. When Abraham first heard from God, he didn't really believe it. He didn't believe it. Same with Sarah. When she first heard about it, she laughed. When she was told that she's going to have, she said, shall my Lord have pleasure in his old age? So she didn't believe it at first. But you know, see, faith grew. Faith can grow. You can increase in it. It can get strengthened. And that's what happened with him. And by the time his wife was pregnant, he before that happened, it says, he considered not his own body, now dead, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. The Bible says, whoso offereth praise glorifies me. So that's what it means when it said to give him glory, to praise him. And so he did not consider his own body. He didn't focus on his body. He didn't focus on the natural thing about the body. He didn't think about, wait a minute, you can't have children, you're my age. He didn't think, well, you know, my wife can't have a child. Sarah can't have children. I mean, she couldn't even have children when she's young. How's she going to have it now? And see, people think like that. They just completely remove the God factor. It's like God's not even there. See, that's natural thinking. That's natural mindedness. You're going to determine what God can do based on some natural facts. You know what a miracle is? It is really a divine intervention into the ordinary course of nature. Some people call a birth a miracle. That's not a miracle. That's natural. That's what's supposed to happen. That's how the body was made. A miracle was Sarah having a child because it took a divine intervention into the ordinary course of nature. Because according to the course of nature, she can't have children and neither can her husband make her pregnant. But God did something different. He did something different. But he can't do anything different as long as you are locked in your mind in the natural. If you're locked in the natural, God is limited. He is limited. You cannot lock yourself in the natural and think God's going to do something because he can't. He can't go beyond what you're believing him for. And so when people pray, Lord, heal me if it be thy will, they need to find what the will is and stop praying that nonsense because it's nonsense. And I'm telling you right now, you're not going to receive praying like that. You are not going to receive. How can you believe? How can you be fully persuaded? That's what I was telling you faith is. It's being fully persuaded of something that have not come into contact with your physical senses. How can you be fully persuaded about something How can you be fully persuaded about something you're unsure of? If you're unsure, then you're not persuaded. If you don't know something is his will, how can you be persuaded that it's his will? You can't do both at the same time. You either know it's his will or you don't know. If you do not know it's his will, then there's something you have to do about that. What can you do? Get in his word and find out what his will is. And stop listening to people. Because people are always going to give you some negative thing, or tell you something that happened and this happened. And I remember years ago, I was in New York, and I had driven there, and I was driving a van, drove there from, I was going to minister at a church there, and my mother was living there, and I drove my van, and I parked somewhere in front of her apartment building, and I went inside, we went inside, had a couple of people with me, went inside my mother's apartment. I had an uneasiness, but I ignored it. See, that uneasiness was the Holy Spirit trying to tell me, don't leave your van there, but I ignored it. And anyway, I did ignore it. And I came out later on for church, got dressed and all, and we came out and we all on the way to church and my van's gone, completely gone, just gone. Well, we called looking for it, you know, had to catch a taxi to the service. And then, I came back, I told the people, you know, looked like, you know, my van was missing, but we'll see what's happening. I had to get a taxi back home. But then the next day, it was still missing. We called to see maybe it was towed because they have, you know, parking on different sides of the street. At different times, you're parking on the wrong side and the sweeper come. They can tow your car and do some time. And so, that's not the problem. So now I know the car is stolen. I know it's stolen. The police precinct was around the corner. And talking to the police, you know what they said? They said, some of our cars get stolen sometime. Wasn't that encouraging? Now, I'm going to have to believe God beyond all of that. And that night I went back to church. Now, I couldn't say, Lord, I can't go to church. I can't preach. I mean, how you let this happen to me? I don't just understand that. I'm up here doing the will of God. I came here to work for you, and look what happened to me. None of that nonsense. I recognize it's the enemy, not God, doing this. So I got up and told the people, I said, well, I've discovered that my van have been, you know, it was stolen. I said, but I want everybody to know that I will get it back. And while we are in New York City, my God is still on the throne. And I went to sit down because they were going to do some other things before I got up to minister. I went to sit down. And the moment I sat down, I heard the Holy Spirit say within me, now, from now on, don't call it a stolen van, call it a returned van. And from that moment on, I said, that van's returned. Now, I had to battle. I had some battles in my mind. I had to battle. I remember the pastor and his wife, we went out to lunch, and they was trying to encourage me, you know. Oh, pastor, the Lord will bless you with another. He'll give you another van. Then they start giving me testimonies of other people who took their van or their car to the mall and came out and it was gone. None of that was encouraging. All of that was discouraging. But I had to dismiss all of that and focus on what I believe. I believe I'm going to get it back. I'm getting it back. I am getting it back. And so anyway, I remember I borrowed my brother's car one day and I said, I'm going to go out here and look for it. And I'm out there riding around and all that. The Holy Spirit said to me, what are you doing? I said, I'm looking for the van. He said, go home. I will bring it to you. So I was having these different battles in my mind. But let me tell you something. Faith will work in your heart even with a doubt thought going through your mind. But on the other hand, faith in your mind will not work with doubt in your heart. But faith in your heart will work even with doubt gone in your mind. Praise God. So you have to understand that. And so I just continued and continued. Make a long story short, that Sunday morning, I had to preach that night. So I said, I'm going to stay back Sunday morning and rest up and so forth. My brother and mother went to church. And I took a nap. I fell asleep. And even while I was sleeping, I dreamed about me not that car not coming back, me not getting it back. I remember waking up, turning over, saying, no, in Jesus' name, it's mine. It is returned. And I fell back asleep. When I was awakened after that, I was awakened with a phone call saying, we got your van. It's down, got it down the street. And I'm telling you, it wasn't down that street before. So the thieves ran it out of just about out of gas and parked it. But I got it back. Imagine if I had said, well, I'm sorry, we don't know what to do. Can't do anything about it. No, you got to think differently. With God, all things are possible. If you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. If you can believe. The problem is not, can God do it? It's, can you believe it? That's where the problem is. The problem is your believing. Really, the problem is your unbelief. Praise God. That's what the real problem is. And so if you're going to pray like that, Lord, if you hear me, if it be your will and all that, you can forget about it. You're not going to get it. Well, I just asked God to have his way. I just told him that and just put it in his hand. Lord, it's in your hand. Whatever happened, happened. Really? Really? Let's see how long that lasts. Because a few days later, a few hours later, a few weeks later, sometime later, you'll be complaining again about how you feel. And it's going to bother you because you turned to the Lord. And you still suffering the exact same way. Still suffering. No difference. What's the problem? Now you don't just, quote, turn it over to the Lord and let it go. There's no. What you're actually doing is turn it over to the devil and you don't know the difference. That's you mean well. But you just throwing up your hand and saying, whatever happens, happens. I just tell God, you know, I just put it in your hand and he gonna do it no matter what. No, you're gonna have to stand and you're gonna have to believe and you're gonna have to not cast away your confidence. Because you have need of patience that after you've done the will of God, you may receive the promise. Now, let me go back to this. Praise God. Now, as I said, the problem is in the application of God's word. The scripture must be applied to the heart. Faith is of the heart. There's a difference in knowing the scriptures intellectually and knowing them on a heart level. Now, once again, this is where I went to my side thought. Those who have difficulty receiving have only an intellectual knowledge of the word. They know the scriptures, but not in their heart. Sadly, many do not know the difference between intellectual knowledge and heart knowledge. So let me give you the difference. Intellectual knowledge gives you a sense of certainty and a general faith in God's willingness and ability to keep and perform his word. But when that certainty is challenged by contradictory circumstances, questions arise along with doubt and confusion, such as, what's wrong? Why is it not working? Things of that nature. On the other hand, heart knowledge has a deep-seated peace associated with it. It is not moved by contradictory circumstances. It remains steadfast. When you believe it in your heart, and you stay that, it stays. When I believe it, Jesus said, whosoever shall say to this mountain, be removed and be cast in the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things, that means believing in his heart, that those things which he says shall come to pass, he shall have, not might. Well, it will, if it's the Lord's will. That's, Jesus said what he said. When you start throwing all these caveats in there, that's you. And you just defeat yourself and beat yourself out of it. You allow the enemy to rob you of things that God wants you to have, because in your own mind, your own thinking, you make a difference. You make exceptions. There's no exception. Whatever God said is true, period. I don't care what anyone says. Whatever God says is true. The Bible says, let God be true and every man a liar. And as far as I'm concerned, everybody's a liar except God. God cannot lie, and he will not lie, and his word is true. No matter what you experience. I hear people say all the time, I know I did that. I did that, and tell them what to do. I did that. No, you didn't. You think you did. You went through the motion. But there's no way for you to do what the Bible says, like the Bible says, and not have what the Bible says. Impossible. Say that again, Pastor Holmes. Why, thank you. Believe I will. I said, it is impossible for you to do what the Bible says, like the Bible says, and not have what the Bible says. Impossible. That can't happen. You got to be missing somewhere. You got to be missing somewhere. And instead of getting upset and bothered and angry with somebody preaching this or teaching this, you need to find out, well, where am I missing it? Lord, help me to see what I'm missing. Praise God. Heart knowledge has a deep-seated peace associated with it. It's not moved by contradictory circumstances. It remains steadfast, fully persuaded that God's word must come to pass no matter how long it takes. Heart knowledge produces heart faith, and heart faith is unshakable. Now, we only have a short period left, but let me get to this part. Heart level knowledge comes by hearing and consistent meditation of God's word, and by a willingness to accept his word as the absolute truth and final authority against any and every opposing argument. Whatever God said is what we should believe. Hey, let me tell you something. If you don't believe that God's word is the final authority, you can make confessions until the cows come home, but you're not going to get anything. You have to believe it. You have to believe it. I believe the word of God is true. There's no need me quoting scripture, confessing things and all of that if I don't believe the word of God is true. I have to believe the word of God is true. You got to believe that, period. And so it's going to take some consistent meditation of God's word, consistent meditation. And I'm going to share something with you. In Joshua chapter 1, Joshua 1:8 says, "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success." I want you to think about that for a minute. Now, that was in Joshua. When it says this book of the law, that's what they had. We have the word of God today, the Bible. So this word of God shall not depart out of your mouth. That means you're supposed to always be saying what the word says. But you shall meditate therein day and night. Meditate in it, not Sunday and Wednesday night. Day and night. You see, our problem is we're inconsistent with things. We don't stay with it. We don't deal with it. You know, sometimes I write out confessions. I've written out confessions to give to the church, give it to everybody that wants it, and they read it. I was praying the other day and talking to the Lord the other day, and the Lord brought that to me. He said, you know, many do not make these confessions on a daily basis. And if I went to church right now and said, how many of you do it every single day? And they told the truth, many of them would not raise their hand. Probably most of them, because that's the way things happen. We get busy doing this and that, and we forget. And sometimes you got to develop a routine. I mean, me too. I mean, it goes with me just as well as it goes for anyone else. And sometimes you have to develop a routine. Okay, I'm going to do this, and follow it. The only way you're going to be able to just be consistent in it, because things are going to be thrown at you. Life happens, all kinds of things. Sometimes the enemy's throwing things at you. But this book of the Lord shall not depart out of your mouth, but thou shalt meditate in it day and night. Now, when you meditate in it day and night, what's the purpose? That you may observe to do. You got to be a doer of the word, not a hearer only, deceiving your own self. That we may observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then, see, when you speak it and get it in your heart, then you do it. Then, it's a combination of those two things. Then you will make your way prosperous. You won't have to be saying, oh God, I need to prosper. Oh God, send prosperity now. Oh God, prosper me. Oh Lord. Excuse me. You won't have to say all of that, because you make your way prosperous. That's a spiritual law. You're going to make your way prosperous. In other words, your way is going to be prosperous. How you make your way prosperous is by hearing and obeying the word. That's your way of making it prosperous. And then not only that, you'll have good success. You will have good success. Praise God. Now, the word meditate in this verse means to mutter. The word mutter means to speak in a low, indistinct voice with the lips nearly closed, according to New Webster's dictionary. And notice that we are to meditate day and night in order to prosper and have good success. The purpose for meditating on God's word is to fill our hearts with it. Now, this is what I was saying here. Heart knowledge comes by hearing and consistent meditation of God's word. Heart level knowledge. The Bible says, faith comes by hearing. It comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. When I hear it, faith comes. When I hear it on a heart level, faith comes. When I receive it on a heart level, faith comes into my heart. So the purpose of meditating on God's word is to fill our hearts with it. Romans 10 and 8 says, the word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. The word of God gets into your heart through your mouth. Your tongue is the pen, and you are the ready writer. And when you speak what the word says, you are actually writing on the table of your own heart. This is what's happening. You're writing on your own heart by what you are saying from the word of God. Amen. This is how the word gets in your heart. The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. Starts in your mouth, gets in your heart. Amen. This is important because it is with the heart that we believe. Faith comes by hearing God's word. Now, here's another passage that substantiates the meditation of God's word. Psalm 1, starting at verse 1. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, or in the word of God. And in his law, or in his word, does he meditate day and night. What happens to the one that meditates day and night? He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. We should meditate on every promise or stated fact of healing found in God's word. We should continue doing this until it's burning in our hearts, like it did in Jeremiah's heart. Jeremiah wrote, "But his word was in mine heart as a burning fire shut up in my bones," in Jeremiah 20:9. We hear a lot about making confessions of faith. But before we start making these confessions or declarations of faith, we should first meditate on God's word until it is as real to us as our very own breath. Listen to Psalm 39:3. "My heart was hot within me while I was musing, the fire burned. Then spake I with my tongue." To muse means to meditate. Once we meditate on God's word for healing until our hearts are burning with it, then we're ready to make confessions of faith, because they will truly be declarations born of a faith-filled heart. Proverbs 4:20 through 22 says, "My son, attend to my words. Incline thine ear unto my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of thine heart." When it says let the word not depart from thine eyes, always keep before you what the word says about you. You keep that before you. See yourself with whatever the word said. If the word says with his stripes we are healed, see yourself healed. That's keeping it before your eyes. You're keeping what he said before your very own eyes. That's what you got to have. That's what you got to keep. And by the way, talking to people, and you know, you just can't stop. You can't stop yourself from being burned if you're going to hold fire to your bosom. You're going to be burned. What you talk about has an effect on you. The words of a talebearer are as wounds. They go down into the innermost part of the belly. You start talking about things and think about how it gets you down. You start talking about what's going on, how kind of problem you have, what's happening here and there, and you get down more and more and more and more. And folks say, "Well, I'm supposed to talk about it. I mean, I'm just telling the truth. This is what I'm going through." Do you have to speak all of that? It may be a fact that you're dealing with what you're dealing with. Is that what the Bible tells you to meditate on? No. It tells you to meditate on his word. The answer is in the word. If you start saying what the word says and stop dwelling on, because look at this. Abraham, the fact, was that Abraham was about 100 years old, 99. And the truth was, his wife was 90 years old. And the Lord talking about them, and they're going to have a baby. That wasn't the first time God made a promise to him. But by this time, we're now at the point of having this child or getting pregnant. Now, what if he said, "Well, I mean, I'm just telling the truth. Oh, you can't be this old and have no baby. I'm just telling it like it is. I'm being truthful." Being foolish, what you're being. Playing into the enemy's hands. Saying, you know, stating facts as truth that is different from what God called truth. Jesus said, "Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth." It may be a physical fact that you're dealing with something, but the truth is whatever God said. And if you're not going to meditate in the word, and if you're not going to trust the word, then you're not going to have what the word of God says. Meditate on the word of God continually, and it'll bring you out. It'll bring you out. Now let me just say something in conclusion here. Because when we talk about confession, a lot of people do a lot of things. First of all, let's understand something. you don't just automatically have whatever you say. That's not true. There's two parts to it before you're going to have what you say. Let's go back to what Jesus said. Whosoever shall say to this mountain, be removed, Mark 11:23, and be cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith or continue to say shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he continues to say. That's what it's saying. Whosoever shall say and believe in his heart, don't doubt in his heart, but believe that those things which he says shall come to pass, he'll have whatever he say. That's what you have to do. Notice it's not just saying it, it's believing it. The next verse says, you know, therefore what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. But let's go back to that verse. Whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be cast in the sea. That's saying. And shall believe in his heart that those things which he say shall come to pass, he shall have whatever he says. You got to do three times as much saying as believing. You need to be saying it. You need to believe it, but you need to keep saying it. What's going to happen when I keep saying it? From my mouth to my heart, from my mouth, a man's belly, the Bible says, shall be satisfied with the fruit of his lips and with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips shall he be filled. Death and life and the power of the tongue, they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. The more I speak, the more I'm getting filled with it. Sit down and meditate on the word. Find scriptures about healing or whatever it is and meditate on it and say it over and over. You may have to say it thousands of times for it to get in you and start burning in you. Say it until you're convinced, because tell you the truth about it, and to be completely honest with you, when you first start making these confessions or declarations of faith, it don't do much about the situation. The first thing that happens is it starts working in you. Out of my mouth, I'm writing. My tongue is writing on my heart. I'm saying what the word says. I'm saying. Now that I'm filled with it, what did Jesus say? Of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speak. Now when I speak, it happens. Why? Because I'm filled with it. But until I get there, and you should start where you are, you got to start somewhere at the beginning, you know, and just start telling yourself and teaching yourself, say what the word says. You got to keep doing it. And then you got to do it some more and some more. And do it some more. And after that, do it some more. And some more. And some more. Keep doing it. Keep saying it. Shut out the noise. And don't be talking to people about what you're dealing with all the time. Stop it. Go to the word. This is what the word says. A lot of people that you're talking to about what you're going through don't have an answer for you anyway. They have no answer for you. They just give you what they think and what they feel, and they, you know, their pity and all that, and pat you and say, I'm praying for you and all. You don't need just that. You need the word. You need the answer. And the answer is in God's word. Meditate. It's consistently doing that that's going to get your heart full of faith. You're going to have heart knowledge and heart faith, and it's going to be unshakable. And if you do it like God's saying do it, like his word says do it, you are going to have the victory. Guaranteed. If you start get in faith and stay in faith, it's impossible for you to not win. You got to do what the word says. Now also remember this, that you have to walk in love in order for your faith to work. I'm just teaching you about how this thing works. Some people doing all, they can been confessing for years, nothing changing, because they got stuff in their heart against other people. Oh, no, I don't have anything. Yes, you do. That's why you're still talking about it. You're still talking about it. You got something in your heart. Oh, no, I don't have any. Yes, you do. Now, you can lie to yourself all you want, but you're still not getting what you're asking God for. What's wrong? Faith works by love. Love works no ill to his neighbor. Whatever God is love. Look at the character of God and imitate that. Imitate that. If you look at the character of God and imitate that character, then you're walking in love. Praise God. I trust you got something out of that tonight. I'm sure you did. Father, we thank you again for your holy word. Thank you for this time, for this moment. Thank you for all that you have done and for what you have done in the lives of your people and what you have done through this message and what you are going to do when people watch days, weeks, months, or even years from now. Give you praise in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I believe you received the answer that you've been asking about. Let us pray. Now, I want to join with you right now. I want to pray. I want to agree with you. The Bible says, if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. And what I want to pray with you, I want to join my faith with yours, believing God to meet that need or bring that request to you that you desire. Now, I'm going to hold up my side, you hold up yours. Because if you doubt, then you're going to do without. Okay? Now, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I thank you for these that are watching right now that have different requests. Some need healing, some need financial blessing, some need a job, some need a house. There's all kinds of needs, and there are those who are there. I am attempting to agree with them, even though I don't know individually what it is. And so just in a general sense, I'm in agreement with those who are having needs. And I pray, Father, for them that you will meet every need, that you will help them to walk in this, that you will help them to see it and understand it in the name of Jesus, that the eyes of their understanding will be opened, that they will be enlightened so that they can walk in these truths and see what you're saying. And Father, thank you for those who will be obedient and begin to meditate on the scriptures, meditate on what you said until that word starts burning in them. And then it's going to come about. I thank you in the name of Jesus. Father, thank you that you are so, so, so good. Oh, you are so great. And we love you and thank you. You are so good. You love us unconditionally. You love us eternally. You love us without reservation, despite our flaws, despite our imperfections. And you are not going to withhold things because of our imperfections. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Father, I come against every devil. You found demons, lying spirits, lying to people, causing them to be in confusion, deceiving them and lying to them about how God views them. Go from those people in the name of Jesus. My dear brother, sister, I want you to understand God loves you, and don't you ever let anybody tell you different. And you can't do anything to change his love for you. Nothing. Nothing. You may do something that'll change your love for him, but you can't do anything to change his love for you. So he loves you. He loves you. He loves you. Praise God. If you're here and if you're watching at this point and you have not received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, this is the time to do it. There is a heaven to gain. There is a hell to shun. Right where you are, just open your mouth and say, oh God, I am a sinner in need of a Savior. I recognize that I cannot save myself. I receive the Lord Jesus because I believe he is the Son of God. I believe that he died for my sins. I believe that he was raised from the dead for my justification. I accept his substitutionary work. He became sin so that I might be made righteous. I receive that, and I receive him now. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Praise God. God bless you and thank you. Don't forget to give to the work of God tonight. Praise God. This is your opportunity to do so. There'll be on the screen different ways for you to give. Praise God. Thank you. Thank you for your gifts of love. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for all that you do to help us do what God told us to do. God bless you, and we'll see you next week and also on Sunday. So tune in Sunday, and we'll see you next Wednesday by the grace of God. Amen.